Guys, we're coming out to the InfoSec Club's second big speaker event of the semester. Tonight we have an esteemed guest from Cisco, Ms. Michele Guel.
Good, you said it good, awesome.
Yeah. And first off, I'd like to thank Calvin for, again, putting this together, our External Affairs Director. If you want to give a quick intro.
Hello, how are you? We started out with Jabari and a couple of guys at the U.S. Cyber Challenge this past summer, and I got a chance to meet some really great people. And from there, I got the idea, you know, well, there's a bigger problem than what we're learning. So I sat down and I got to thinking, and the more I thought, the bigger the solution I came up with, and it just kept going bigger and bigger. And someone just said, well, Calvin, let me introduce you to somebody. And that person introduced me to Ms. Guel. And she looked at me and she said, baby steps. She said, baby steps. So I hope you guys will take advantage of this. I learned something that you never know who you're talking to. When we met, she told me, she says, oh, I know who you are. And I looked at her and I said, huh? She goes, well, I Googled you and I did something else. And she goes, and you don't look like a preacher to me. Ta-da! So I'm going to try and do this. It's tit for tat, right?
This could be embarrassing.
it's dealt, right? Dite.
Dite.
There we go. That tells you I did a little homework. I'd like to introduce Ms. Guel. Thank you.
All right, y'all ready to go? Wake you up, get engaged, be alive. I don't stand in one place. And I keep the audience engaged, okay? So like you said, my name's Michele. I'm like, who's the esteemed guest? Is it me? Oh, okay. It's going to be comedy night. Did y'all know that? Stand-up comedy? Although I was just told that engineers are a little weird. We don't talk to anyone. We're kind of heads down, you know, behind the scenes. Or whatever. All right. How many of you, just a little level setting, and I'm glad we got our requisite 10% women. I would just would have liked if y'all would have had more presence in the front. Come on, show me some love and sit up here. How many of y'all are under 25? Okay, most of you, good. Good, anyone under 20? All right, we got some youngins here. My oldest grandchild is 27 years old. I have 12 grands. All right, so today Calvin asked me to talk about my career journey. Right, I'm sort of an oddity, and I'm like, oh no, if you did the Google, and y'all can go out and Google, you might find some interesting facts. If you find some real juicy stuff, come back and let me know. You know, we had a conversation this morning. I was teaching a class from 6 a.m. to 8 a.m., lovely hour, for a group of Cisco folks in India. They've been, you know, so they don't have to travel out. We're doing it WebEx, and I get up at the lovely hour of 5:15, which is not my favorite hour, especially when I go to bed after midnight. But it's part of the global workforce. So I met Calvin a couple months ago, and I always, you know, when you're meeting someone at Cisco for the first time, and you don't know who they are, you really should look them up in the directory. Right, so you need to know if it's male or female because you can't tell by the name. You want to know what they look like and a little bit of idea. You just don't kind of walk in there and blah blah blah. Right, so when Calvin was going to meet, I'm like, well, I better look up Calvin just so you know I can watch through the door and welcome him. And there was another Calvin who was a preacher, and I'm like, I don't think he's a preacher, so he must be this other guy over here. And I was right. So he come walking up, I'm like, all right, that's Calvin. I knew who I'm talking to on there. So we met a couple months ago. And I'm all about cybersecurity. I'm a real cybersecurity geek, can you tell? Do I like look like that? Is this like what you expected, right? So I hope today to really inspire you, to motivate you. I'm here to answer questions. I have slides, but that's just more to keep me on track than to keep y'all reading the slides, okay? I'm gonna talk about what's on the slides, but we can go all over. Feel free to raise your hand. I do like to call on people. And so I It was funny, we're walking over the, so I called Calvin, he says he sent me the room number, but I couldn't find it in the email. And so I am driving over here, and I'm like, okay, I know San Jose State's off 7th Street. So I get off 7th Street, and then I couldn't figure out how to get in the parking garage, so I parked in a garage. I know the path, I think, to get back to that garage. So I go out to Macquarie Hall, and I'm like, I better call Calvin to see where it is. He's like, where are you standing? I'm like, in front of Macquarie Hall. Okay, what are you wearing? I'm like, I'm probably the only one in the university that has Converse pink tie-dye shoes. And so I'm waiting, and I'm looking, and here come these four young dudes, right? They had their little dark glasses on. I'm like, the men in black, all right. They kind of walk up. I give them a shell, and I'm like, yeah, all right. So we'll go over there. So it's all good. So some words that describe me, and I normally do a lavalier mic. I don't like this thing, but we'll kind of work with it. There's a lot of words that describe me. Loud, rambunctious, no, those are on the slides. I'm a very official. I'm very distinguished, can you tell? Very distinguished. Leader, fighter, survivor, geek, stubborn, overcomer. I'm a stepmom, I'm a grandmom, I'm a great-grandmother. I have two great-grandkids, right? Can you tell? Right? I also have two titanium knees. These guys are like walking really fast, and I'm like, dang. Parked on the wrong side. I'm sporting some double titanium here, over here. I also do a lot of ministry. I don't have the official name of pastor. My husband's a pastor, and there are many that call me pastor. So I'll talk about my various careers. Beginning years, I learned something new today. I figure, well, there's a lot going on in my life, and I figure today about one, I should probably look at my slides just to kind of make sure I'm ready for the talk. And I was looking at something else. 1962 was significant for several reasons, not just because I was born. Okay, that's a pretty big event, make it significant enough. And I know that was like the rock ages for some of y'all. But it was also the year that malware was invented. I didn't know that. I learned that today. So I was born to be a fighter of malware. Now, is that cool or what? I think it's pretty cool. So I'm going to use that on my resume from now. I was born the same year malware was created. I wasn't the malware, but I was born to fight malware, okay? I was part of the, in the younger in my generation, when you were, I'd been moved, when your parents worked for IBM, they got moved around a lot, and so I was one of them, I'd been moved kids, went around, and so been in California since I was in kindergarten, a long time, you know, do the math there. I had a very traumatic childhood, and I'll explain, that kind of forged some of the paths that I took. But how many of you, when you were in elementary school, you knew what you wanted to be? I want to be a fireman. I want to be a policeman. I'm going to be a hacker. What did you want to be?
I wanted to go into network security.
All right, cool. When you were 5 years old?
It was actually when I was seven.
No, that's not funny, because how many of you had your first electronic computing device by kindergarten? Okay. Right, my two-year-old grand, he's not two-year-old now, but when he was 2 years old, he knew how to get his mom's smartphone, he knew how to unlock it, he knew how to search for his favorite app, which was the choo-choo train, and then he dragged the animals to the choo-choo train and he would smile. I met another five-year-old who knew how to download in the app store, go find the games that he wanted. So today, many children, they're connected electronically from birth. And so it's quite relevant you're going to have a young man who's 5 or 6 years old that likes to tinker in computers. There's nothing wrong with that. That's cool, because we're electronically tied. They're very interesting. My first computer, don't laugh, I'm in high school, a TRS-80. You have to go to a computer history museum to see what one of those looks like, but, you know, whereas compared to now. Okay, so maybe in high school, how many people knew in high school what you wanted to do? How many people wanted to do network security in high school? Software engineering? Hardware engineering? What are y'all in? Am I in like creative arts or something? I thought this was like InfoSec. Okay, so we didn't know. I didn't know. My first thing I wanted to be was a jockey. Can you tell? It was pretty apparent by junior high, I was never going to be a jockey, okay? I already weighed 120 pounds, and you got to weigh like 110, and my mom's like, sorry. Okay, I got to figure out what I wanted to do next. The next thing I actually wanted to do was I wanted to be a forest ranger when I was in high school. I like the outdoors. Exciting, huh? Again, we're talking late 70s, early 80s, when we actually had a lot of forests. But then doing the research, they only made $30,000 a year. In 1978, that wasn't very much. And so, okay, that's out. And I'll talk how I got to where I was. But my actual first job was a paper boy. Anyone deliver papers? Well, in the olden days, we did it on a bicycle, right? We had the big old bags. My second job was a painter. I used to make $15 an hour painting houses, right? Yeah. Hard work, but I liked it. But there was something, even in my time, right now we talk about, how many people always say STEM? What do we mean by STEM?
Science, technology, engineering.
All right, 5 points for the young man up here in red. Good job. But there's a lot of people, like mostly dudes in here, okay? Mostly dudes in the room. That's average in industry. I can't tell you how many years I was the only female in the room. And it's different for the women. And like if you're all dudes and there's one female in the room, it's kind of awkward. If you're the one female in the room of all dudes, it's like really awkward, okay? And so, but there's such opportunities. And so you kind of see that reflected here. Here it is, 2015, and we're still struggling with the approximate 10%. Right? And even we see a whole drop off in the whole electronic industry, the high tech industry, when there's just so much opportunity. And it's an exciting world what you can do. I mean, man, the opportunity, if I could have had my first iPad at 5, or my first, you know, Apple computer at 5 and doing logo programming, which probably doesn't exist anymore, but it did way back then. You know, now we do Python, you know, we have all these sub-languages, we're gonna learn Java and program, write our first app in first grade or something like that. And so I always took a lot of, you know, science classes in high school, knew what I wanted to do, right? When I was a junior, I wanted to be in the nuclear Navy. I'm all over the map. I'd be like, what is this girl talking about? She's like, all over. She doesn't know what the hell she wants to do. And so I actually went through the whole process to get a congressional nomination and got nominated in the Air Force Academy. But my one of those scores was like 2 percentiles too low. You know, it had to be 94, and I was 92, so I didn't make it, even though I had the congressional nomination. So I ended up at San Jose State University. Now, is that pretty cool? I started in September 1980, and many of you weren't born yet. Well, Calvin probably was. Feel me, Calvin, right? And I was majoring in physics. How many, any physics majors here? You guys are smart. I was majoring in physics till I got to quantum mechanics, and I couldn't quite figure out quantum mechanics. I'm like, okay, physics is not for me, hello. And so I switched to math. Boy, was I. I have no idea how I graduated with a math degree, okay? My mom was like, you can't even balance your checkbook. What are you doing in mathematics? But it was the closest thing to computer science in 1980. And I really kind of dug it. Don't worry, we're going somewhere like this. I studied American Kempo, one of the dudes, this dude right here, he studied jiu-jitsu. I'm like, oh, you do jiu-jitsu, cool. Right? I used to do martial arts. You know why I started martial arts? Because I was going to San Jose State University. In 1980, the rape rate was pretty high. So I was going to make sure I was going to be protected. I was going to be badass. Nobody's going to touch me, right? So I actually did martial arts. Oh, sorry. Erase. I was going to do martial arts. But that's important because how I got in computer security was during a karate lesson, and I had a calculus question for my karate instructor. True story. 1980, probably October, around there, just started college, and I was in calculus, first calculus class. And he's like, are you taking any programming classes? I'm like, no. Who would take programming classes? And he's like, to make it in this industry, now we're talking 1980, you have to have programming. I'm like, okay. So the next semester I took my first programming class. Guess what it was then? What language do you think it was? Again, you have to go to Computer History Museum, but
Fortran.
I should have gone to my mom's house and got my first program. Punch cards. Yeah, I did Fortran. And actually, I had an aptitude. I was one of the people who got an A in the class, and most people were failing, so Fortran was kind of hard. COBOL, I did COBOL. How about some other so 80s language? Anyone?
Prolog?
No, I didn't do Prolog. APL, Logo, Pascal, Lisp. Do they do any of those anymore? No, very archaic. Okay. I did C. I actually, is it here? No, yeah. Actually, I had a detour. This is going to get raw and real. Because what you think you're going to do now, you're probably not going to do your whole life. Life's going to happen. You may meet the women of your dreams. Okay? And she doesn't like you. Maybe you already have. I don't know. But you guys are in the front, so I'm going to use you. I'm just saying. Part of the career journey is things happen along the way, and you have detours. Life happens. Sometimes pretty bad things happen. Right? A lot of bad stuff happened to me as a child, and I had a complete breakdown in college. Was suicidal. That's why I was on the 9-year plan. It actually took me 9 years to graduate. important thing is I did graduate, and I kept at it. And I actually had another detour. I was like, you know, I wanted to be the nuclear Navy. Then I went to ROTC. I'm going to be an Army Ranger. All over. And but I had bad knees then, and I got 4F'd out. It's all good. But what I did do, now remember my karate instructor asked me if I was in programming? Well, he had a startup company. And so I started my first job at 19. I was a programmer at 19. And you know, if you go to the Computer History Museum in Mountain View, you can probably see something called an HP 3000. And there's this language called BASIC. And I programmed in BASIC manufacturing programs on an HP 3000. And then during lunch, we played this game. I can't think of what it was. Calvin, you might know. Started with an M. Anyway, it was like, it was all command line game. Not like you have today, and it was real excited. Started with an M, and you know, you go here 10 steps, you're in a cave, and there's a candlestick by the wall.
Adventure.
No. Oh. Who know? Anyone? Start with an M. No. And then you get the candlestick. There's a defender down the hall, and he has a knife, right? And so it was like, you'd be totally in this, and you can stop and connect the game. We're talking early ages, but it was pretty cool. So I was a programmer, and I learned how to administer system and do backups. You know what? I had an aptitude for programming. How many of you programmers? How many program? What language? C, Python, Java?
Java, all of the above.
All of the above, okay. I'm a grad student at San Jose State now. I'm in my second class, very challenging. I don't know if my instructors are here. I didn't do so well in my first class because I hadn't done any math in like 20 years. I don't like Fermat's theorem. I don't like Gallows fields. I don't like what all that other stuff. I can't remember, but at least I passed the class. Amen. All right. Amen. And so another interesting thing is I got to program on the very first AT&T 3B2. Again, you have to go to the Computer History Museum that was in California. And this box ran C. I didn't know C, but there was another language. I don't remember what it was. So I converted into a language. I started from a language I didn't know. And I translated into a language I didn't know. How do you know that was some good software I wrote? You're supposed to laugh at that part. Okay? And so that went under. So now I'm just turned 21, and I look like I was 16. Okay? I'm 52. Do I look 52?
No.
Y'all was like, no way, man. Yeah, I'm 52. That's okay. When you're over 50, you're fabulous. When I turn 50, it's all about fabulous 50s. I know that's your parents probably aren't even 50. But so I went to work for NASA Ames when I was 21 years old, which is not unusual now. I mean, how many people are working in the industry now? You already have your first job, 21. How old are you?
25.
25. Okay, well, how many people are like 21, 20? In the back. All right, first job, you're already working for, so that's not unusual now, which is cool, right? You go to school, hopefully get an internship, you go to work and all that, but back then it was unusual. So they're interviewing for my first job, and she asked me how old you are, which they can't do now, and I said, I'm 21. She goes, oh, you're just a sprout. And I'm like, do not put that in the bulletin about me hiring on. I don't want everybody to know I'm just a sprout. It was a playground. Just again, defined you. How many people like to dinker? This young man, what's your name?
John.
John, he got all like, John, all right. You like the dinker, right? You know, it's like, programming's like puzzle, disassembling. How many people program in assembler language? Okay, y'all are weird. I had to do my first assembler language this semester, and I kind of got the hang of it, but okay. Yeah, I mean, how many people like the dinker? How many people love to hang out in the debugger and look at all those memory addresses and map the stack? Okay, I really needed you to help tutor me in my last test because that was a really hard stuff. Okay, but you like to tinker, right? You like to take it apart. You like to build stuff. So what's an exciting project somebody's working on? Young lady right there in the colorful shirt. Yeah, she looks, no, her shirt's black. Your shirt's very colorful.
I didn't work for that.
Pardon me?
I didn't work on that.
Oh, you didn't follow that?
I didn't work on that thing.
Okay. What about the? She's taking a sip. I'm going to sip right now. You, young lady in the green, what's something exciting you're working on?
The current courses. So basically, we are programming in Java. So
I just started last night, my first Java. So all right. Okay. Who's working on something super? Anyone writing any robotic code? Sensor for IOE. Wait, this dude right here. What's your name?
Well, it's Hanson Wu.
Hanson. All right.
I'm still in the very early stages, but I'm trying to write a website extractor, just basically extract the data and...
Are you a threat actor?
Probably not.
Good. So you're trying to extract data from websites?
Yeah, basically like news articles. I just want to extract the text.
Oh, cool. All right.
Copy paste is too time expensive. So I want to do automate it.
Mm-hmm. All right. Cool. Who else? Who's got something exciting? You in the cool blue shoes there. He's all like, me?
Well, I guess for one of my operating systems class, I'm going to eventually start on writing multiple threads and writing that in C.
I would have no idea how to do that, so totally cool. You must be really smart. All right. Anyone else? Something like, who's like, you think is the coolest thing you're doing? Anyone working on anything, Internet of Everything? Programming a sensor? Anyone got any wearables? What do you got?
Working with my roommate to build a little robot that'll play Tetris for me.
All right, cool. They still play Tetris?
Yeah.
All right. That's an oldie but a goodie. Anyone working on setting up their own secure infrastructure at home? Tinkering with the firewall, ACL. All right, I knew this young man over here was, okay, cool. What kind of equipment you got?
32-bit computer.
VMs. All right. Anyone else? Anything?
A Linux server, SSH, and also HTTP.
Okay.
So I post my own website, but people try to brute force SSH into it all the time.
I see. Well, that's good. All right. Anyone who's like, okay, you're not going to want to raise your hand, but let's see. Who's running the cool pen testing tools, Metasploit, all that sort of stuff. They're pointing to the guy in the back. They were pointing to you too. All right, and I know some of you went to the whole cyber defense. How many people participated in Capture the Flag? Now, I'm not talking about the one where y'all go out in the park and y'all run up the hill and grab the flag.
That one's fun too.
That one's a fun one too. That oldie but goodie. All right, how many people real Capture the Flag? Got a couple here, right? I have no idea what Capture the Flag is. How many people have no idea what Capture the Flag is? All right, cool. Now we can talk about something. You're going to learn something. There are actually a lot of resources. I don't have them in here. But Capture the Flag is an excellent way just to see what it's like, right? And we have this one of our, is my Paul Nguyen here, my instructor. So anyway, one of our midterm questions is kind of a capture the flag. It's like you're given a boxes or an environment, and you don't really know anything. You just land. It's like you've been transported to a planet. Okay, you're in the middle of San Jose State University. You must compromise three buildings. You must find the goodies. You know, where is the blah, blah, blah in whatever building? You know nothing, but you're in the middle of San Jose State. You have your smartphone. Okay, you got a smartphone with some tools on it, Google, map, whatever. And the object is to find the goodies. And so in the cyber world, which is pretty cool, right, some of these folks, I've never actually participated in Capture the Flag until my final. And I'll tell you about, now I've been doing cybersecurity for 26 years, which is a lot longer than many of you have been born. But I'm more about the infrastructure side and not the programming side. But Capture the Flag is an excellent way to just learn and think or even work with someone who's done Capture the Flag. Right? Do you know? How many people there in the back? I can see some faces. How many people, throw out some numbers on how big a shortage of cybersecurity professionals do you think there are in the world today? Throw me out some numbers. Calvin, you should know. Throw me out a number, Calvin.
1 million.
Oh, Calvin, you weren't supposed to get it right. How many people would actually think 1 million shortage of workers? In 2014, the Cisco annual report in 2014, last year, 1 million. There's a lot of opportunity. It's an excellent field because there's always something different. You could be a pen tester, a good kind of pen tester. How many, maybe you don't know what pen tester is. Those are like the dudes up here with all the exploit tools and they're trying to make sure your network is secure and so they're gonna try to break into your network. It's like Capture the Flag. Or you could do forensics. How many people like to watch CSI? You're engineers, I forgot, bad question. Okay. So, you know, you could be a forensics expert and you're picking bits off the drive, right? Or you could be the one where you're writing secure software design In Java or in C, it's like, it's really hard. That's what I learned in my class. I used to program in C, and I'm like, how in the hell does anyone write secure code in C? Now we're going to learn how in the hell they write secure code in Java. You could write secure software. What about hardware? How many hardware folks here? Oh, no hardware. Okay. Oh, we got one. All right. One hardware engineer. Cool. There's a whole factor about securing the hardware. A whole opportunity. Trusted, you need to know that the device is trusted. They have these things, Cisco has something called Trust Anchor. Right? How do you know, do you know what I mean by supply chain? That's okay. So here's just a scenario. How many people know, this is just a real scenario actually, how many people heard of Huawei? Do you know what, so telepresence is a Cisco product. You know how Huawei got their telepresence product theorized? Well, Cisco's shipment of a telepresence used to China went missing for quite some time. After sufficient time such that theorized Huawei engineers had time to reverse engineer the hardware, Huawei suddenly had a telepresence product. Of course, it didn't work as good as Cisco's, but they had a product. So supply chain security, you may think that's actually kind of boring, but end-to-end, think about all the parts, even in the whole manufacturing floor. When you think about automation and IoE, that you can ensure that no one's tampered with any aspect of the hardware from the time it gets constructed and built to the time it leaves the plant to the time it gets to its destination. There's huge money in that. People take products. They take a lower-end product. I'm not saying you do, but it's possible, right? They take a lower-end product. They buy some cheap extra parts off the black market. They create what looks like a higher-end product, and they sell it, and they make lots of money. Of course, it's not the actual product, but there's a whole fraud in that. So there's tons of interesting things you can do in the whole cybersecurity realm, even if you like to talk and do marketing. So just that was a little sidebar conversation. Was that interesting or no? You guys like, this is so boring. All right, but the thing there, part of that, it leads into my next slide, is you got to know you can forge your path. How many people are ready? I mean, you're excited, you're eager, you want to work in the Silicon Valley, you want to be big. But he's going to have his own company. I know this guy is like, yes, yes. You want to be CEO? Or a CTO? Chief Technical Officer?
Perhaps that.
Yeah, okay. No, but serious, I mean, how many people know right now that you want to be a CEO? Nobody. Okay, that's kind of interesting. How many people know that you want to be a CTO, Chief Technical Officer, or Principal Engineer? Right? Y'all aren't shooting high enough. Okay. Right, well, I didn't know either, honestly. When I was your age, I had no idea. I wasn't even like, someday I'm going to be a distinguished engineer. I am the first female distinguished IT engineer at Cisco. And there, in the whole DXE community, there's distinguished there's a lot of distinguished engineers in engineering. They have all kinds of engineering, the whole different broad spectrum. You could be a support engineer, you could be a customer, you could be marketing, and all this sort of stuff. Overall, there's probably like 200 women. There may be 25. On the IT side, there's 16 dites, and there's one woman, me. So that was a huge accomplishment for me in my career, but when I was your age, I didn't know that. I didn't know I should go and be a programmer. When I started programming, I found I was very skilled at it, like many of you here, you know, doing all kinds of stuff. But the thing is, you could forge your path. You got to think about, now's the time, if you haven't thought about it. Now's really the time to think about what you want to do. Tremendous opportunities. I mean, Internet of Things, Internet of Everything. Does that sound exciting? In your home, okay, well, I'm going to network my refrigerator, my Nest device, my alarm system, my cell phone, my potty, I guess the flush, in case I forgot to flush it, right? And my egg carton. All right, what are the opportunities there? Tremendous. What about wearable? What about if you were the person that invented the next super cool device like the contact lenses that sense glucose levels? And through wireless technology, transmit that data. But you have to do it securely. Lots of opportunities. You're talking about a little micro. When you think about sensors and then the Internet of Everything, tremendous security challenges. Because now you're all endpoints. How many people have a Fitbit or something like that? Okay, well, y'all are young, so you're always active. You don't have to worry, do I do my 10,000? When you're my age, like, I did my 10,000 steps because I worked over here. It's like, okay, I'm only on 5,000. I got 10,000 more to do. Okay, what about, you know, you got your smartphone. I'm sure everybody has a smartphone. Any unlucky soul that doesn't have a, you have like the old flip phone that deet, 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 or you got a text? Okay. Many of you probably have a tablet. What, anyone have any Google Glass? No? Any other spaceship parked in the parking garage? You know, in another 20 years, that's a possibility. Car? My car has, I think, 14 computer boards in it. My tires, I can actually press a button and see how much air I have in my tires, right? We have already have automated driving. There's been proven attacks on smart cars. There's been proven attacks on all the smart technology. What about if you're the one wearing the insulin pump or the cardiac pump or the, you know, the sensor in your eye and somebody decides to be mean and DOS you or give you too much insulin? We've already proven that they could have targeted assassinations because they're using smart technology. What about if you were the person that designed the security controls around that? Does any of that sound exciting? Are you like, we're here to talk, right? Endless opportunities. I didn't know that. What I can tell you, when I was at NASA Ames, my job was a playground. I was the sprout. I did everything in the Vision Research Lab, from make the coffee, clean the lab, to develop programs that the scientists ran to run experiments. I got to rebuild a Sun 1, change the backplane. I got to install NFS when it was actually brand new. I got to forge a path to how to run an NFS at NASA Ames, Network File System, for those who haven't heard it. But in the early days, it was like, what is this? No, we can't do this. And I got the Dinker. I didn't know how to do that. I just pulled out the schematics. I can rebuild it. Took it all apart. Like, damn, I better rebuild it. I'm in a lot of trouble. Right? Reading schematics and just like, I'm going to try it. How many people just try stuff? Right? That's how you learn. You got to forge your path. You got to be exciting, right? We know the guys are notorious for trying to build stuff without the instructions. How many of you like that? Forget the instructions. I can build it. I don't need no stinking instructions, right? That's the dinkering. You got to try that stuff. It's exciting. There's all kinds of stuff, right? Lots of important stuff that you can do. Okay, how many people have jailbroken your phone and want to admit it? Ooh, you're no longer supported by your cell phone company, okay? Let's see, NBC, two arrested, okay, all right. And there's some things where you have to use wisdom, right? So at Cisco, you know, when you talk about mobile technology, here's the whole kinds of security around mobile technology, and because the millennials, you are all millennials, I don't know what's gonna come after millennials. What do you think's next after millennials? Zillennials? Millennials? I have no idea. That's like my grandkids right now. They're under 10. They're the next whatever. Y'all are all millennials. I don't know what I am. What I am? What are we, Calvin? The boomers? The baby boomers or something like that? We're the stone ages in there. But think about the whole what's required, because we all have our own personal phone. How many people get your email? Pictures, website, app store, videos. Right. What about in a company, right? I have my Cisco email on here, and y'all, one of y'all steal, can you tell I'm from Texas? When do y'all steal the phone? I'd have to report it to Cisco, and they're going to remote wipe. I lose all my personal data. But because of the way that business runs and the millennials like you, you grew up on electronic technology, so you want to be mobile. I mean, how many people carry a laptop around? Because you have school, right? Not because you want to. It's like, man, this thing, like, can't I just do it all on my iPad? When I was in college, see, I can do this, because when I was in the olden days, you know, I took the bus to school, the 64 line, which, actually, anyone here remember dial riding, the older folks, Calvin, right? You used to, the bus lines out here, you used to dial, and for 10 cents, you could ride the bus. So I used to take the bus to San Jose State there, and I kind of forgot where I was going with that whole thing. But you know, it was going to be a good story, but maybe I'll come back to it. But just think about the whole mobile technology and how to secure that. I was talking about millennials. Oh, because they're so connected. I know where it's going. So when I was in college, see, I know I remember. You know, when you're my age, you kind of have the old-timer moments. I had the, well, you guys probably have real school books. Do you still use real school books? There's a, well, I don't now, my master's program. I like my iPad because I have my 4-inch books on Kindle. When you're a freshman, you have a 4-inch calculus book and a 4-inch physics book and a 4-inch chemistry book, you're going to have shoulder injuries because that's a hell of a lot of books to carry. Now I got all them books on my iPad and I like that. So technology, right? That's a cool sort of thing. So think about how are you going to forge your path and do what you want to do? I challenge some of you to really research, because I know San Jose State has it in the summer, their cyber camp where they're going to be offering the capture the flag exercises. I know this gentleman's really, I can tell he's got that look like, you know, I'm going to try, that sounds really cool. He's probably really uber smart. And he's just kind of playing it down right here, right? He's probably already got it all figured out how to capture the flag and all that sort of stuff. He's going to talk to these gentlemen because they probably, and the young lady probably did really good in capture the flag scenario. They actually have contests across the United States, and I think, I don't know if the folks from San Jose State University, but the government runs lots of contests, and when you win the contest, you go to the next higher level, and the Uber winners get grants and all kinds of stuff because we have a shortage of workers. So I really encourage those folks, if you're on the fence thinking about it, and I know, I forget your name because I'm a little bit older, so young gentleman right here, your name again?
John,
I was thinking Jordan. So have you done a capture the flag?
No, I haven't.
I bet you're going to do one this summer.
Probably,
okay. So I challenge you to all, Mike, fill up that class, make it full, really see what it's all about. It's kind of cool. It's hard, right? But, you know, sometimes it's easy, but, you know, it's hard. So forge your path. Think about what you're going to do. How are you going to make an impact? And in part of that I'll talk about is really, what do you want to be your legacy? Now, I know y'all are young in the early 20s, so most of you probably don't need a relationship or have any thought about kids and that whole whatever thing. But your legacy is not all about work, right? We work because we need to, you know, we have to have money to pay the bills. We want to buy a house. We want to buy the nice car and all the toys, electronic toys that go with that. But our legacy is more than just what we do for a profession. Really think about where do you want to go? And you're in charge of that path. So how did I ever get into cybersecurity? It used to not be called cybersecurity, but I used to not like that term, but I'm cool with it now because it's more of an industry standard, so we can kind of go with the flow on that one. But how many people have read about Morris? Robert T. Morris. Anyone? A couple? Good. You know, I knew the dude over there, the advisor, probably know about it. But, you know, can you actually believe there was a time when information security wasn't even on the radar? That was only in 1988. So Robert Morris, much like you, I'll just flip and I'll go back. Much like you, undergraduate, actually almost looks like John here. I think John had glasses. Right? Nice smile. His father worked for the NSA, and he was a dinker. He liked to dink. He was just testing out some things, wrote a little program. Oops, right? Went from East Coast to West Coast in a matter of hours, took down lots of computers in the path. I happened to work at NASA Ames at the time. And all of a sudden, all of our computers, the supercomputers, and everything else was going down. Anyway. Read up about it. But why? That was my, because I was a system administrator and they needed a response. We didn't even know, well, what is this thing? What do? What happened? How did they get into here? So this was before firewalls, believe it or not. We're just all flapping out there on the internet and do that. So that's how I got my start in cybersecurity. And so, and then, you know, I was going to leave, and they said, well, what would you like to do? We want you to stay, create your job, and we could use it. I'm like, that sounds good. I'll do security. I didn't know what that was. And so I got to forge, again, think about forging your path. What do you want to do? We need some standards for sensors for the Internet of Everything. It would be really cool if a couple of you, you know, half a dozen of you got together and thought about, what do we need for the default security features for sensors? You could have totally an awesome company. I think this gentleman and John should get together, these men and black in the front, and think about what that is, because it's really needed in the industry, okay? And then from there, just it took off. I've had the opportunity to do a lot of fun stuff, but you know why? Because I was the deeker. I was always about learning something and giving away that knowledge. I've been teaching in the industry since 1991, and hopefully most of you were born by 1991, but maybe not. Teaching in the industry since 1991, when there was no industry. And it was interesting, you know, you ever seen the cartoon, you can be anything you want on the internet, it's a dog sitting in front of the keyboard? I was one of that, because what do you think people, when they heard my name, who do you think they was when they only saw me on the internet? What's the male of Michelle?
Michael.
So true story, I go to conferences and they'd see me and like, I thought you were Michael. No, Michael's my brother and he knows absolutely nothing about computers, okay? I got that for years, and so it was actually a benefit that on the internet you can be a dog and nobody knows it because they just assume I was male. Had they known that I was female, maybe I wouldn't have done as well because in the 80s, there wasn't too many of us. So many, many years, I was the lone female in the room of Tonka trucks, as I call it. Yeah, super uber smart guys. And when you get an opportunity, take advantage of it. I connected up with some folks who helped me along the way. Got to do a lot of really cool stuff, investigate incidents. We had one, and we called it the Australian Invasion. I wrote a paper on it. A young gentleman, much like these men in black here in front, who liked to dinker, but he liked to break in and dinker, right? And so, and then he liked to brag about it. So he broke into NASA Ames computers, and then he went to the public, the paper in Australia, had his picture on the front page, and he had a little cartoon of the shuttle. But before he did that, we were in the whole, you know, the search and whatnot. So today we have all those nice automated tools. I'm using basic DNS tools and ARP and all that sort of stuff to find out what this dude did. And I even had an informant back in Australia, and we got involved with the Australian Federal Police. So it's interesting stuff. You can do a lot of interesting stuff. How many people heard of the SANS Institute? Cool. Good institute. Good classes. Good classes. Okay. I started working with SANS in 1991. Back in, if we had badges, I would have badge like 7 or 8, but we didn't have badges. I've never been an employee. Alan Powell, who's the founder of the SANS Institute, I didn't invite to talk, has been my mentor for however many 20 years, that is a long time, 20 plus years. And I think a future speaker of yours is going to be John Stewart. Anyone know who John Stewart, Chief Security Officer of Cisco? Maybe April. So in 1992, I interviewed a college kid, John Stewart, who totally aced the interview gauntlet. So in the olden days, we used to have so many resumes that we had to read them, like actual printout and read. I know, you know there's these things called printouts and printers, and you read through the resume and you mark them up with a pen, where today you have software to do that. And we'd have tons of resumes. You still have that today. And so you know, you go through and you kind of sort out. So I get this one dude's resume, and I'm like, oh, this guy sounds pretty cool. So I call him up, and we just totally hit it off good. I'm like, okay, I like this guy. You know, we kind of gel, and you know, we can connect. And he was coming out for the interview, so he was a college kid on the East Coast, and he was going to come out. And in those days, we flew him out for the interview. I said, two rules. I said, do not show up in a suit. I will show you out the door. Rule number one. I forget what the second rule was, but that was the most important rule. Right? And I did show people. I was like, if you got through the interview with me, you were pretty damn lucky. I tell them on the way in, all right, listen, we have a lot of candidates, and if at any point during the interview we feel you're not a fit, we will show you out the door. Now, how's that for the first 5 minutes? You're like, sweating bullets, totally. How many people have been out on interviews? All right, cool. You like the experience? No, it sucks, doesn't it? But that's, you know, great. It's great to get experience. Even when you think about, man, I didn't get the job. And then you learn for the next kind of interview experience about how to have presence, how to have confidence. I can tell this guy would rock the interview. Confidence, he's sitting up here in the front row. Right, I'm kind of geeky in these guys, and John here too, right? So anyway, John Stewart, when I interviewed him, when he came to work for me, 21 or 22, I said, you know what? I go, dude, someday you're going to be super famous and remember your roots, right? And so he's Chief Security Officer of Cisco. Now he's my step-level boss, which is kind of cool. But I got to do a lot of fun stuff. In information security, there's so much fun stuff you could have. Raids, working for all the three-letter agencies, the FBI, the CIA, the OSI, all this sort of stuff. Because at NASA Ames, in the early days, there was no expertise. And it was kind of fun in the beginning, then it got kind of a bummer. You know, I get called in a room, Well, the first time I was called into the secure computing facility, I'm sure they still have those, you go through all these big metal walls and you can't take your cell phone, and we were doing a raid at NASA Ames and we always had to be in the presence, all this sort of stuff. And I'm like, okay, well, that was kind of fun. I did another raid, and this was kind of a cool, because it was for the San Jose, and we were raiding a company, and we went to the police station, and this is something y'all could do, so this is cool, that's what I'm telling you, right? This is a potential career. You could be one of those people that really helps out law enforcement. You're like the Uber forensic analyst is going to determine what the hackers did, okay? So we're in the police station, we're having it just like the movie, seriously, we're in around the table, we've got all the different agencies, they're talking about what we're going to do, and here I am, the only civilian, this young, whatever I look like, kid from NASA Ames, because I knew how to do computer stuff, there wasn't a lot of other ones, and we go up and we go behind the building, and literally, just like the movies, they all get out, whoosh, the jackets, FBI, police, and here I am, no, where's my jacket? Civilian, right? I thought that was kind of cool until all day I had to be escorted everywhere I went, including the restroom. I'm like, I gotta go pee again, right? And it was kind of a bummer because I didn't get out of there 12 hours, and then I had to go before the grand jury and all that. And the trial's like 3 years later, and you can't remember what the hell you did. You're like, Judge, I honestly don't remember. I remember the jackets. That was cool. I don't remember much else what I did. So there's a lot of things that you could do from that perspective. I mean, the FBI's in not as much as they used to be. I mean, you know, they were pretty desperate because I actually taught the first security class for the FBI in California somewhere in the 90s. I don't remember where it was. But literally, they just didn't have the expertise. So they're desperate when they get a kid from NASA Ames to come teach them about cybersecurity and what to look for. Now you could totally have an awesome career in the FBI being the Uber hacker, good hacker kind of thing, right? Or the Uber code writer writing all that encryption, right? There's, maybe you don't want to work for the FBI, and that's okay. But I'm just saying, there can be some like really cool stuff that you could do out there. It would be fun and exciting. I got to do it as a civilian. Then it was like, okay, I've done all that. I want something a little bit more relaxed. Because that's kind of hard to work. And it gets scary, right? On one raid we did at NASA Ames, and it was kind of a bummer because we closed down all the buildings. In the olden days, before you could like black hole stuff, you actually unplugged the computers. That's when there was actually like wired connectivity, and you actually had to go to the office and unplug the computer. And then we had to come back the next day, and I had to write code with the OSI agent standing behind me. Now talk about pressure. Dude, I can feel you breathing on my neck. Okay, I'm forgetting how to program in C because you're like there and you're like on-demand programming. That's not the fun stuff to do, but that's cool stuff. There's lots of opportunities there. All right, so we were talking about Morris. Interesting thing. So if you don't know about Morris, and here's the challenge of the information security field. Now, Calvin said I could talk for 4 hours, so it's all good. Y'all don't need to go anywhere, right? Are we okay here? I'm at least entertained, and hopefully you're like, wow, there's a lot of cool stuff you can do with information security. I hope I have some converts after this. I'll be able to be protecting my home network. Y'all be trying to get in. All right, so the reason I have this, and I had to go find the report. This is actually was written in 1989. I was the NAS numerical aerodynamic simulation security team. And you know, you read all these, but some of these things organizations still do not do today. They're pretty basic on here, but they don't do them today. A lot of organizations struggling with what we call the basic block and tackle of having a good secured enterprise. And that's really my sweet spot of what I do, because I've done a lot of different things. Like, you know, I used to manage the Cisco firewalls. I tell them now, dudes, you do not want me on the firewall devices, okay? You do not want to give me the enable password because I forgot all the commands. And I made mistakes back then. You know, anyone ever got the net mask wrong? And then you just shut off all the network traffic? Oops. Why does Cisco just went black? Oh, Michelle was making an ACL change sort of stuff. And well, you're going to make mistakes, but the opportunity is many organizations, even big organizations such as Cisco, are in need of cybersecurity professionals. We just got done hiring in the last 3 months. We've hired 40 new people in the InfoSec team at Cisco. We have another 40 recs. That's a whole lot of hiring in 6 quarters. We have an intern program. We bring interns in. We actually have 2 people that work for us. We're interns from San Jose State. They work in our InfoSec team. They work in the SOC, the Security Operations Center. And they're like, you know, one of them's like the Uber engineer. I'll probably hear from it, you know, real quiet. We're engineers. It's all good. I used to be really quiet. I'm actually really quiet if I don't have a mic. I just want to be like you. I just want to sit in the back, very like, don't look at me, don't ask me any questions, sort of stuff. All right, so there's lots of opportunities out there, okay? That's the message, lots of opportunities in the cybersecurity field. One of the things you got to be successful in your career is be bold and fearless. How many people skydived? Anyone here? A few hands, all right. Brave soul back there, like 3. I did it for my 30th birthday. I encourage you to do it before your 30th or 40th birthday. It's real exciting, especially when you're afraid of heights. How many people bungee jumped? Don't bungee jump, just skydive. I'm afraid of heights. But you gotta take that steps and be adventurous, right? I actually challenged, quick story. I challenged at the martial arts studio where I was, my husband, that's where I met my husband. I've been married. I met my husband in 86, 85. We got married in 98. We kind of did the BC, you know, the before Christ. But we did the olden way. We got married. We were together for a long time. Anyway, we met at the martial arts studio. And for his birthday, he wanted to go bungee jumping. So I did a surprise visit. He had a lot of fun. I did. I was just watching. I'm like, no, you do it. And we had a friend come up. And then so we went back, and I challenged the head instructor. And this gentleman, again, will get it because you don't challenge the head instructor at a martial arts studio. I challenged the head instructor, like, we should all go bungee jumping for the spirit camp. And he's like, you're on. You will jump too. So here's all these heavy-duty black belts. We're driving up to Davis to do bungee jumping. And some of them on the way up, they're just like, I am not jumping. They were like, they didn't care if they were fifth degree, but I'm not jumping. They were the smart ones. And so we had like 10 or 15 people, you know, and one guy actually went up to the top, had a total panic attack, and they brought him down. He was all gray and sweating. I'm the last one. I'm the one that had challenged the instructor, and I'm afraid of heights. And the platform is like, no kidding, this big. You're 150 up, you get up there, and you run on the bungee, and you're on this little bitty platform. And everybody's down there counting. There is no turning back, okay? Once they start counting, you're screwed. You gotta jump off that platform. I'm like, ooh, right? And so that was my bungee jumping experience. I get down to the bottom, and my husband, who's my boyfriend at the time, he's like, you screamed all the way down. I'm like, I did not. He shows me the video, blood-curdling scream. All the way down, and then I'm like bouncing all around. Of course, I was about 50 pounds lighter, so I'm like bouncing all around. I'm like, what was I thinking? So then we got this thing, okay, let's bungee jump. Bungee jumping is totally not like, skydiving is totally not like bungee jumping. You know, at 10,000 feet, looks the same. At 5,000 feet, looks the same at 1,000 feet. You can't tell you're going 100 miles an hour. Bungee jumping 150 feet to the ground is like, oh my goodness, it's scary. So all that to say is you got to be bold and fearless. To be successful in your careers, you have to take those mistakes. I mean, you have to take those chances and make a mistake. How many people have made some totally foobarred, failed? Anyone failed the midterm? I did. Okay, all right, cool. Yeah, you're trying stuff, right? Anyone in a Linux operating system or Unix, anyone do an arm star at the wrong directory? All right, John, cool, John. All right, I'm feeling you, John. All right. When I was at NASA Ames early in the morning, I was doing some administration, and I did that in the wrong directory on a production box. Oops, at least it was really early, and so I could like get the system restored before all the scientists came in. But you learn from those mistakes. You gotta be able to willing to make those mistakes just to make things happen, right? So you gotta be bold and fearless. And remember, you're in charge of your career. You can really be anything you want. I like the fact that I can wear jeans and Converse. Y'all probably thought I was gonna show up in a suit and be all kind of stiffy, but that's not my style. You're not gonna see me in heels and all that sort of stuff. I have very low princess qualities, and I'm cool with that. I can be a princess when I need to. But you'll see me in Converse and jeans most of the time at Cisco, and I talk to senior staff. It's all good. And actually, Rebecca Jacoby, who's the CIO, she'll walk in and she'll, oh man, I like your shoes. They're all jealous because they can't wear Converse and I can. So, right? So you gotta be bold and fearless. How many people are ready to be bold and fearless for your career? You wanna do something exciting? That's like, you know what, oh, the hell with it, I'm gonna do the cyber challenge this summer. How many, anyone like that? All right, see, I knew that dude over there was gonna get it. What's your name? Jake?
No,
Jawahar. Oh, Jawahar, okay. I can say that. I'm not good with all the names, but I worked for a Jawahar at Cisco, and he was like uber smart. He was a dyke too, then he went off, and now he's like way on this other side, super smart. So cool, right? You gotta step out and just try. You're not gonna know if you like it until you try. You're gonna like, what? That's what I did. I'm like, hey, security sounds interesting. It was fortunate for me that I made that decision that I was like one of the forerunners. Now there's all these like uber smart young people, but at one time I was one of those uber smart young people that kind of forged what the information security field was all about, and then I went out to teach other people about that. You know, the legacy that I want to leave, and that's the legacy that I'm leaving, is mentoring and encouraging others to do that. Especially women. I was one of the founding members of what we started at Cisco on Cisco Women in Cybersecurity. We were hoping to get 200 people in the first year. In the first 3 months, we got 143. A lot of tremendous excitement, right? And you get, and for women, young women, when you get other young women to band together, I'm like, the dudes all got it down. You know, they're football and they got the big old chest bang. All right, dude, way to go, right? The women need to, because I'm serious, you guys do that, right? You see in the whole sports and all that kind of stuff, right? The women have to be better at doing that and encouraging each other. And in finding to have that voice, because when you're in a room, like when I got promoted to Dite, there was a baker's dozen. We had 12. There hadn't been any promotions for a long time, and now there was going to be 12, 11 guys and Michelle. Now you get a bunch of Dites in the room, competition. You know, that first meeting, it was like the sea of Tonka trucks. You know, my Tonka truck's bigger than yours, right? And I'm like, I was the roadster. They were all the Tonka trucks. You have to be able to hold your own in that meeting and have a voice and speak. Because it can be a little bit intimidating, right? If you're the newbie millennial on the block and you're going into a meeting with a lot of seasoned technical professionals, you got to know your stuff. Like, you know, these guys could sit and speak their stuff and have presence. In a class I taught a couple weeks ago, we had two millennials, and one of them got the highest score on the test. I'm like, dude, you rocked it totally. And he signed up. He's like, you know what? I'll teach a class. He may not be the best teacher in the world, but on a call with like 30 people, he was the one that was gutsy and said, you know what? I'm going to try to do that. And I applaud that. That's awesome to do that kind of do that sort of stuff. So steer your career. You got to be bold and fearless. All right, so my Cisco journey, which I've talked a lot about, right? So I started in 1996, so next month, in March 18th, will be 19 years. Anyone 19 years old here? Anyone just 19? John is. All right, John. That's a long time. You're thinking, dang. You know, today, most people don't stay at a company for 19 years. They only stay at a company for 5 years. Because it's, you know, but you think about it, well, why would you want to move around? Now, how many people right now are you thinking, you know, I'm going to go work for Google, and I'm going to stay there the rest of my career? Anyone? Facebook, Yahoo, FireEye. He was going to raise his hand. That's all right, cool, I want to work for FireEye, yeah. All right. Any other, you know how many cybersecurity companies there are? I don't even know. But last year at RSA alone, there was over 400 different vendors. That's like a 200% plus increase over the previous year. Lots of opportunity and potential. As we move into the Internet of Everything, it's even more needed. So you can see all kinds of vendors and competition. You know why there's so many vendors? Because they're gutsy. That's why you get FireEye right down the street from Cisco, or you get Juniper, or you get all these potpourri type companies, and now it's all about cloud services. Everything's as a service. Security as a service. You know, today we were talking about trusted services as a service. Right, you have an untrusted device, this is a true security scenario. You have an untrusted device, you're on vacation in Hawaii and you want to check your email. You would like to be able to do that from an untrusted service, but if you can have a kiosk that can broker through a trusted service as a service and download the necessary requirements, you can do what you wanted. That's a better user experience. We were having that conversation at my 11 o'clock meeting, the gentleman that was describing it. So there's lots of opportunities to be creative and create new companies. New ideas, innovation, fast, you know, innovation is all about failing fast. Is it going to work? Is there any, like, instructional, I don't know if it's the right name, instructional design classes here at San Jose, anything that focuses on innovation? No. Man, I don't know. The only reason I'm bringing it up because last year, the leadership team, we went up to Stanford and we were in this, it was called low resolution innovation. And it was in their instructional design, and it was like totally cool. Not even what you think about. So the room, it was like, it was all stand up.